Ira Cohen was born in 1935 to deaf parents, and was subsequently raised in the Bronx's deaf community. He would later credit this experience for instilling in him a particular discipline for visual communication. Cohen came of age in New York's downtown scene at the height of its psychedelic and Eastern mystical curiosity. He spent much of the early 1960s undertaking the sorts of journeys that had become rites of passage among the beat poets. He lived in Tangiers for a time, with William S. Burroughs and Paul Bowles, following the same exotic trajectory as figures like Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, and Irving Rosenthal. Cohen was a prolific but largely unheralded poet, and by the mid-1960s had established himself as an important publisher of underground magazines. He would remain focused on poetry until his death in 2011. But his greatest success and his most influential contribution to psychedelic art was his Mylar chamber, a room in his New York apartment that had been decorated entirely with rolls of Mylar. These strange reflections allowed for extraordinary distortions of a subject, bending light as in a funhouse mirror, pliable enough that the bend of that light could be manipulated. With Mylar, Cohen could stretch faces, elongate fingers, and curve bodies in the smooth, bulbous, unbroken lines of post-Picasso figuration. In his photography, he often used this effect on subjects bearing bizarre and often grotesque face paint and prosthetic makeup. Cohen found himself immersed in a world of Renaissance sensibilities and surrounded by artists who often worked between music, cinema, and the visual arts. Cohen would make a 16mm underground film that would serve as a declaration of his spirituality and as a vessel for the plastic illusions of his photography. The invasion of Thunderbolt Pagoda set Cohen's Mylar chamber in motion, along with the cast of strange and often terrifying figures that had occupied it. These characters were fully realized in Cohen's poetics, the Majun Traveler, the Methodron Cardinal. For the invasion of Thunderbolt Pagoda, Ira Cohen developed a large ensemble, the Universal Mutant Repertory Company, a collective of 34 performers gathered from New York's downtown scene. Among them, underground filmmakers Sheldon and Diane Rochlin, underground movie star Beverly Grant, and musicians Tony Conrad and Angus McLeese, who were then members of the Theater of Eternal Music. The film emerges out of three strains in Cohen's work. First, his interest in the relation between expanded consciousness and the forms of knowledge and communication that were being revealed by a new age of media art and philosophy. His ensemble is an electric tribe, if not that of Marshall McLuhan, then certainly that of Andy Warhol's Exploding Plastic Inevitable. Second, Cohen's interest in the possibilities for spiritual and physical transformation through the bending light flow of Mylar reflections. And finally, his preoccupation with occult fantasy, in which figures are transformed into a psychedelic bestiary, by prosthetic makeup, face paint, and trick photography. The Universal Mutants could at once be an androgynous congregation performing a black mass, or a commune of free souls engaging in collective dreaming in a lost paradise. The soundtrack, by Angus MacLise, supports Cohen's ideas through sensory overload, mixing tape manipulation and feedback with heavily overdubbed flutes, bowed strings, and drones. Cohen planned the film in three parts: the opium dream, Shaman, and Heavenly Blue Mylar Pavilions. The first of these sequences, the Opium Dream, offers up the imagery that the Living Theatre's Julian Beck would later use to describe Cohen's film, when he called it a combination of Kabuki Theater and Doctor Strange, implying that Cohen was at once arcane and foreign, deeply Western and pop. In The Opium Dream, figures enact strange rituals while smoking from pipes, figure and pipe distorted by mylar, transformed by fantastical costuming and makeup into gods and devils. The Opium Dream establishes the film as a trip. Through its anesthetic haze, it gives a tour of underground styles and introduces the film's own cosmic iconography, prominently featuring a robed sorcerer and figures costumed as snakes and bats. Cohen's preoccupation with Pan-Asian aesthetics are present in the kimonos, pipes, face paint, hand fans, and the textile patterns of outfits and curtains. The Opium Dream depicts a candlelit ritual, a feeding of beasts, symmetrical mirroring and mylar distortions keep company with more direct imagery of these exchanges. Cohen presents a wholly realized imaginary space where the Universal Mutants, their symbolic totems and baubles, and the technology which transforms them become a unified whole. This is at its clearest, leading into the climax of the sequence, as kaleidoscopes and mylar reflections collapse all of these elements just before the appearance of a dancing reaper and the start of a frantic ritual orgy of violence and music. The invasion of Thunderbolt Pagoda bears debts to underground films not merely of its era, but from its immediate community, such as Jack Smith's Flaming Creatures, a film with which it shares multiple contributors. It is also reminiscent of the films that Ken Jacobs made as extensions of his and Smith's street theater performances, which often featured carnivalesque clothes and makeup. The overt presence of occult imagery, suggestive at times of Egyptian and Tibetan mysticism, links the invasion of Thunderbolt Pagoda to the magic lantern cycle of Kenneth Anger, in particular to inauguration of the Pleasure Dome, Anger's hallucinatory technicolor reflection of his fascinations with Aleister Crowley and the esoteric faith of Thelema. Like Anger, Cohen is not only making art, but gathering an unconventional family under the sign of an idiosyncratic faith. And again, like Anger, Cohen is staging a performance, a history of the mysteries, a history of appearances. He summons his repertory company to the bent mirror of the ancients. Through it, they become primal vessels of poetry, technicians of the sacred. The second sequence of the film, Shaman, takes this ritual out of the Mylar chamber and into the verdant green pastures of a sunny day. Men and women play music and dance, enacting a strange ritual in nature. This hippie pastoral is due to be complicated by Cohen's trick photography. The Mylar distortions had enhanced the mystery of the set in the opium dream. In Shaman, the light of the sky makes the background of distorting leaves and branches both finite and impossibly deep. The Mylar splits faces so that a single figure appears to move in two different directions. The ensemble lays on the grass, their heads together, passing around the sorcerer's golden orb. A kaleidoscope splinters and repeats their faces, multiplying six bodies into a growing field of flesh. The illusions of Cohen's mylar and kaleidoscopic photography remind of Sidney Peterson's extensive use of anamorphot lens distortion in his films of the 1940s. Anamorphic distortion of the image allows the subject to be stretched vertically and horizontally as the lens is adjusted. For Sidney Peterson, this became the most accurate mirror for the bent souls and fractured identities of his characters and of post-war experience in general. In the first two sequences, Ira Cohen's trick photography serves a similar purpose. It abstracts the image and develops an atmosphere that supports its mystic traits. Backgrounds become murky and distant, and familiar sights are rendered in unnatural dimensions, realizing the strange citizens of the Mylar chamber. The final sequence, Heavenly Blue Mylar Pavilions, is the most abstract. It is a rendering of blue sky in fluctuating mylar, a subject that allows the pure distortions of the mylar itself to come to the forefront. The material fact of Cohen's process is at its clearest, but the reflections are no less mysterious. The mylar reflects fleeting bits of image. In the foreground, Cohen's hands wave a wand, repositioning the folds in the mylar's surface. The final image is of a water droplet dancing on this wavering sky. When the invasion of Thunderbolt Pagoda was restored in 2006, Cohen made a new introduction using the film's outtakes. In this prologue, Ira Cohen is buried alive nude, his Universal Mutants hoisting shovelfuls of mud on him while performing a Dionysian ceremony. Only once he is fully cocooned within the mud does he break its surface, sitting up out of it in a trance. Reincarnated as one of those dying and reviving gods of James George Frazier's The Golden Bough. His mad stare is fixed on the camera as he pulls himself to his feet to lead the burial party in a procession, dancing the conductor of his own mysteries.